popular guys of towns. One is the Beat Generation in New York, a walking tour of Jack Kerouac's city, and the Beat Generation in San Francisco, a literary tour. And he's doing the same thing here in Italy and Naples. He is described as here to work on the places that Beats visited when they were in Italy and in Naples. So he's going to give us an idea of what they did when they were in Italy. This is his future work. It's a pity, in a way, that he could not meet our most famous expert of the Beat Generation, Fernanda Pivano. You all know her. And she is here represented by some of her books. And she was a real friend, and she was the one who made these people so very popular in Italy. That's why even now we have a lot of thesis on him, especially Chiquero, I must say, but all of them, his book as well, very well known. And that's also why many of those books get stolen in the library very often. These are the most stolen books in the library, especially the Italian version, the Italian translation are the books that go very easily. I have to keep an eye on them because they are so attractive. In a way, it's a recognition of the attractiveness of this writer. So it's interesting. Yeah, it's true. It's true. And so I always keep them closed because otherwise they disappear. But okay, this was my little introduction. And before I stop, I ask you to turn off your cell phones if you have them, or just to put it in a silent situation so we don't disturb Bill. And here to you is Mr. Bill Morgan. Thank you very much.
Now, to wait for my eyes to adjust so I can read what I want to say. It's an honor to be asked to speak at the National Library, and thank you for hosting this talk, and thanks to everyone for coming out. If anyone wants to sit down in the front row, it's not like church, we don't take up a collection, but please be comfortable. I'm a typical American, and I only speak one language, so I hope that most of you will be able to understand me. And if you need any help, my wife Judy speaks very good Italian, and Lucia, and they can make me sound smarter than I am. I'll just hope that they'll correct any mistakes I make too. And I'll talk for a little while, and then maybe we'll have time for questions and answers if you want to ask any questions. Maybe I'll speak for about 35 or 40 minutes, and I'll show you pictures of some of the members of the Beat Generation. And I'll begin by also going over a few of the things that they did here in Italy and in Naples in particular. I'm just beginning to work on that book, and so we just had a little interview with a man from the newspaper, and I was sorry that I hadn't finished that book because those were the questions that he wanted to ask. So if any of you know any tips about what the Beats did in Naples after the talk, let me know, because that's why I'm one of the things that we're doing while we're here on our trip. Now, let me see how this works.
That's it?
Yes.
Okay.
So I think it'll be pretty straightforward unless I have to back up anything. I've done books on the Beat Generation in New York City, in San Francisco, and most recently I did the whole country of the United States. But now I'm starting to trace their lives abroad, and maybe it'll be called The Beats Abroad, or Guide to the Beats Abroad, or something like that. But it isn't surprising that many of them visited and lived in Italy because it's such a wonderful country. Who wouldn't want to come here if they were able to? When I began work on the new book, it surprised me, though, just how many of them had been here. Almost every one of the writers of the Beat Generation, it seems. So it seemed appropriate then that I talk a little bit about the history of the Beats in Italy. And like I said, I don't have all the details. So if anyone can fill me in on other people and other adventures they had, let me know. Perhaps the first of the Beats to visit Italy was William S. Burroughs. Burroughs was living in Mexico City in 1951 when, many of you might know, he accidentally killed his wife, Joan. They were both drunk, and they were playing a game of William Tell, which they played from time to time, and Joan put a glass of whiskey on top of her head and dared William to shoot it. And William missed the glass but hit her directly in the head. And here's a gruesome picture Alan had. Alan, whenever I mention Alan, it's Alan Ginsberg, had in his archive. For a while, it looked like his lawyer was going to be able to get him off from a murder charge, but before the trial, Burroughs' own lawyer was involved in a murder. And he fled the country and wrote back to Burroughs saying, you better do the same thing. So in 1953, Burroughs went to Rome to stay with an old friend of Allen Ginsberg's by the name of Alan Anson. And this is a picture of Alan Anson on the left and William Burroughs on the right, a little later in there in Greece. But Alan Anson was William H. W.H. Auden's, Whiston Auden, no, secretary, and Auden lived on Ischia. Now, it turned out that Burroughs hated Italy, and I didn't tell the reporter that. He wrote back to Ginsberg during the first few days, and he said, in all my experience as a traveler, I have never seen a more miserable place. Now, Burroughs, you have to understand, was very cranky, and you can't believe anything he said. He used to write home and say, thank God I'm back in London after being in Paris for the last year. Now I can get some real food. So he had his own thing. Burroughs was gay. He was addicted to drugs most of the time when he was here. So he didn't feel welcome or at home in Italy in those 1950s. Wasn't sympathetic towards him. So after a few weeks, he moved on to Tangier. And that's where he lived off and on for most of the next 20 years. Anson, though, loved Italy. And he moved on from Rome to Venice, and many, many of the Beats first came to Italy to visit Alan Anson in Venice. And this is a slide of Alan in Venice when he was visiting Anson in 1957. He and his companion Peter Orlovsky and Gregory Corso, the poet, all stayed with Anson for months at a time. And during that period, they all made their first visits to Rome and Naples too. Alan and Gregory especially enjoyed visiting Pompeii. And in the summer, Alan went over to Ischia to see the poet William, W.H. Auden, who was living in Forio. He lived there every summer for 10 years. Auden did, not Alan. Then in 1958, Harold Norse moved to Naples. Harold Norse is the one on the right, and just so you'll know, Shig Maram is the person on the left. And Shig was the bookstore manager for City Lights Books, and it was actually Shig who was arrested for selling the copy of Howl that then went on to make Alan famous. It wasn't Lawrence Ferlinghetti originally because he didn't sell the book personally, but Shig sold the book. But Harold Norse moved to Naples and taught at the American Studies Center here in 1958, and that was part of the USIS service. It was at that time in, I cannot even speak names, so it was in the Largo Ferentina. And actually, we just found out that the USIS library is what began the American section of the library here. So all of the books on the shelves here are some of the same books that Harold Norse would have been dealing with when he was working for the USIS. He spent a year and a half living on the Via Posillipo and wrote some of his more important early poems about Naples. Then beginning in the 1960s, Judith Malina and Julian Beck, seen here with Allen Ginsberg, again a little later picture than the 1960s, but they began to visit Italy, and they always performed in and around Naples. They were famous for taking theater into the streets and involving the audience in their productions. And sometimes that caused problems with the authorities. You might recognize Julian here. He played Tiresias in Pasolini's movie Oedipus Rex. Julian died now. It's been more than 25 years ago. But Judith is still active. And every year she performs in the Living Theater productions, and they spend their summers often in Italy performing around the country. And just a few years ago, they had a large exhibition of their works at the museum in Castel Sant'Elmo. And we have a copy of that catalog. It's a beautiful, beautiful catalog of the Living Theatre's work. And then Ginsberg returned to Italy dozens of times before his death, which was in 1997. And here he is in his later years with his translator in her later years, Nanda Pavana. And that's who many of the books over on this table are translated by her and by her. When Alan was asked to read at Spoleto at the Festival of Two Worlds, he was arrested by this very policeman and charged with using obscene language in public. That was very typical of what would happen to the beasts. They would use street language in their poetry, and if the authorities wanted to, they would crack down on them and arrest them. And it took many years, maybe you know the Italian legal system even better than I do, and it just took years and years to go through the process, but eventually the case was thrown out of court. Shortly after that incident, Alan met with Ezra Pound near Rapallo, where Ezra lived. And again, Nanda is here on the right helping translate. The meetings Alan had with Pound were very important to Alan. They influenced his life and his work. He regarded Ezra Pound as one of the great poets of the English language. And then during the last 15 years of Alan's life, he became a very close friend of Francesco Clemente, who's an artist who was born here in Naples. Alan knew him in New York City, but he came to visit them in their house in Amalfi in 1995. It was just when Alan was beginning to get sick, and it was one of the very few times we ever knew Alan to take off an entire week from his life of being a poet when he vacationed there. And he really enjoyed it, staying with Francesco and his wife Alba. And he counted the stairs from the beach to their house in Amalfi. He said it was 180 steps. One of our people is a Buddhist here, and Alan always said he was sorry it wasn't 108 steps, because that's a very special number in Buddhism. And Alan wanted to have a photo book, in fact, once, and when the publisher refused to put 108 photos into it, Alan threw a bit of a tantrum. But it's about the only time I ever knew Alan to take time for himself, and I wrote down a postcard that he sent from one of those times, and it'll show you how many words he could actually get on a little postcard, too. He said, food fresh, pasta local, lemon trees in backyard, garden, 8 terraces, behind roomy apartment, newly tiled, I have bedroom and bath to myself, 180 steps up into crowded jumble of houses, up the hill from beach, hotels, shops, tourists, seafood restaurants, where you eat lunch while watching 2-year-old twins bathe. Arches top of hill across from me is graveyard, red tile roofs below. I sleep late, sun deck has big view of Mediterranean, great place to convalesce and rest, a whole week, nothing to do. Very typical of Alan. A postcard, sounds like a poem. And of course, Lawrence Ferlinghetti comes to Italy nearly every year. He's 93 years old now and still very active. And he was just in Italy last year. He's proud of his Italian ancestries and thinks of Italy as his adopted country. And of course, there's Gregory Corso, who came to Italy and lived here for years and years. He visited Naples and wrote a great deal about the ancient monuments here, and he was very impressed by the Sibyl's cave at the Cuma. Or is it Cuma? Cuma. He lived in Rome and loved Shelley so much that when he died, his ashes are buried at the feet of Shelley in the Protestant cemetery in Rome. And this is a picture of his grave. And it is unbelievable that if the camera were just panned up, there's his favorite writer, Shelley. And at the very end of his life, Jack Kerouac came to Naples to promote one of his books, which was published by Mondadori. By then, he was a terrible alcoholic. And he disrupted everything with his drunken behavior and everything he appeared at during that week. This picture was actually just taken a few weeks before he took that trip to Italy. And you can really see how bad he looks. His age here, if you can believe it, was 44. He looks much older. He died at the age of 47. And if I haven't mentioned Amiri Baraka, and he was here shortly in Naples after the attack on the World Trade Center. And he made news when he read a poem in which he said that the Israelis were behind the attack. He also lost his, he was the poet laureate of New Jersey at the time, and he lost his position as poet laureate for writing and reciting that poem. Now, most of the photos that I use in this collection were taken by Alan over the years, and I should say something about myself, just so you understand why I'm here, I guess. I worked for Alan for 20 years before his death in 1997 as archivist and then editor and bibliographer. This is a picture that Alan took of me when I'm sitting at his kitchen table, just like you saw the picture of Gregory Corso at the table. Everyone who came to visit Alan sat at the kitchen table. That's where we did our work. That's where the meals were made. That's where he sat all night. And he took pictures of people. And all the pictures you see will be pictures from his collection. And this is just the one of me. I spent those 20 years putting Alan's papers in order. And here's an example of one of the millions of pieces of paper that Alan saved during his lifetime. He saved everything, in fact, and was famous for that. This is a letter to Jack Kerouac in 1945 when Alan was training for the Merchant Marine. And it just gives you some idea about Alan's handwriting, and it was my job to try to sort these out, date them if I could, organize them, put things together, and then we sold his archive to the Stanford University in California when Alan needed money in order to buy an apartment in a building that had an elevator. For the first 10 or 15 years, we worked in Alan's apartment, and he set this old plank up in his kitchen, and we used that as a desk. And you can get some idea of the massive papers that he has when you look at this picture of Alan bent over his desk. Then in the later 1990s, we rented a real office in a building that had an elevator, so we'd have space to work. And you can see it's just filled with stuff. And since Alan's death, we've been busy editing his books, his collected letters, his collected essays, his earliest journals, and then letters to Gary Snyder. And I did the biography of Ginsberg a few years ago. But that just gives you some idea of my work with Alan. Some of you might know that in America, the Beat Generation became mixed up with what were called beatniks. And I always like to start off my talk with something funny from that period. And I found this ad that ran in the newspaper for Rent a Beatniks. The poets actually started this in the 1950s when there was a big beatnik craze. And they hired themselves out to go to parties. And if people wanted to see what beatniks were like, they were willing to accept the money to go on display. And I like the phrase, badly groomed, but brilliant. So today, instead of talking about these writers, though, as a catalyst for culture and social change, what I'll try to stick to is their literature and explain to you why I don't even believe there is a beat generation, at least not in the literary sense. It's odd because I spent 40 years writing about the Beat Generation. All my books have the word Beat Generation in the title, and I don't believe it exists. Before Alan, I worked for Lawrence Ferlinghetti, and since then, I worked for Gregory Corso, and Gary Snyder, and Diane De Prima, Michael McClure, and William Burroughs, and Jack Kerouac's estate, and not one of those writers believed that they belonged to the Beat Generation either. I always find it kind of interesting that the people who thought they were beats are not people that we commonly even consider to be beats. Some of the people were actually friends more than they were members of a literary group. It was just a small group of people who centered around the gregarious poet, Allen Ginsberg. And it's my opinion that he was the glue who held them all together. You're probably all familiar with artistic groups and movements like the Surrealists and the Dadaists and the Abstract Expressionists, and here are the Cubists. And they're all identified and united by a type and style of work they produced. In fact, often I can't tell if a Cubist painting is by Braque or Picasso. So similar are they in style. And I made it a point to not remember which is which here, because both of those were by two, either Picasso or Braque, but I can't tell them apart. But you can see that they're members of a group, the Cubist group. In literature, it's just the same. There are the language poets, the romantic poets, the surrealists, and so on. And they're all linked by some common element of style or theme in their works. Maybe they just shared a common philosophy about their work, but there's something in common that holds them all together. But when it comes to the Beats, I always wonder, what do these writers have in common? Why is Gregory Corso considered a Beat writer and Charles Bukowski is not? And why are Ed Sanders, Charlie Clamel, and Ann Waldman called members of the Beat generation when they're clearly members of an entirely younger generation, in some cases 30 years younger than the people we consider Beats? For example, when Ann Waldman was born, William Burroughs was already 32 years old. And yet Norman Mailer and J.D. Salinger are never considered Beat writers, even though they are contemporary and wrote about the same kind of things and dealt with similar themes that most of the Beat writers dealt with. Jack Kerouac named the generation in 1948. He's the one who first said it was Beat. And he used that word. He had heard it from Herbert Humpty, who hung out around Times Square. He was a junkie, in fact, and a hustler. And he meant by that they were beaten down, they were worn out. And Kerouac was not referring to the writers when he first said that, but he was referring to the people of his generation who had come through World War II, and they were looking for something more than the 9-to-5 job, a house in the suburbs and two cars in the garage. He felt that that generation had been beaten down by World War II. Then in 1952, this man, John Cleland Holmes, used Jack's phrase Beat Generation for the first time in print in the New York Times. And Holmes also wrote at that time what's considered the first Beat novel called Go. But by the time Holmes wrote that article in the New York Times, Kerouac was already changing his mind and saying that the Beat generation had really ended in 1949. So what I'm saying, I'm not saying that the Beat generation wasn't absorbed into our culture, as so many things are. In America, the most famous member of the Beat generation is not Ginsberg or Kerouac, but it's actually this guy, who many of you might remember as Maynard G. Krebs. My apologies if you don't know American television, but back in the 1950s, the many loves of Dobie Gillis that had Maynard as one of the characters was very popular. And Maynard was depicted as being lazy and dirty, but lovable, tremendously ignorant of everything, though. One of his favorite lines was to react to someone saying the word work. And any time it was mentioned in conversation as just a word work, he would get a terrorized look on his face and say, work! Like he had never even considered that as something. That's not what the Beat writers were all about. A newspaper columnist during that time compared the Beat generation to the Russian satellite Sputnik that had been launched in 1958. And so he put the two words together and he called them Beatniks because he said, they're all far out, man. And from then on, it became mixed up in the public perception with that cultural stereotype. And then that gave way to hippies and the counterculture of the late 1960s. But basically, beatniks had little to do with the Beat Generation writers. They were just cardboard media creations. Most of the Beat writers tried to distance themselves from that term, and that's why they refused to acknowledge that they're members of the Beat generation.
The encyclopedia says that the early hippies' ideologies included the countercultural values of the Beat generation. And when you look at this picture of some of the Beat writers during the later 1960s, you might agree with that definition. But who was the encyclopedia talking about when they said that? Kerouac wasn't personally countercultural at all, and the flower power and hippie movements didn't spring out of the values of William Burroughs or Gregory Corso or John Cullen Holmes either. You might think that the more widespread use of drugs during the 60s had something to do with that connection. But many of the Beats who used drugs, like Burroughs and Humphrey and Corso, didn't have any interest in psychedelic drugs, like LSD, and they certainly never promoted their use. In fact, William Burroughs visited Timothy Leary, and this is Timothy Leary with Neil Cassady on board the bus, Ken Kesey's bus in the early 1960s. But Burroughs visited Leary in the 1960s and tried some of the magic mushrooms himself and didn't like them at all. And he immediately labeled Timothy Leary as a charlatan and an opportunist and never wanted to have anything to do with him. So even though he was considered one of the prime users of drugs from the Beat generation, he wasn't interested in this conversion to hippiedom. And so I wonder what the encyclopedia's legacy is there. In order to prove my point, I picked a few excerpts from some of the best-known writers just to give you an idea of passages from their books to see how different they really are. I think they're representative. I'm not trying to come up with some oddball items to fool you. I wish I could mimic the voices of each of the poets because half of the pleasure of hearing them read their own work is in their own cadences and rhythms and voice. Gregory Corso was born in New York City in 1930, and if anyone was a typical character of the Beat stereotype, it was Gregory. His parents were from Calabria, and he was abandoned as a child and grew up on the streets of the city, almost as an orphan. His father was still around but didn't want him until World War II began. Then his father wanted him back so he wouldn't have to go into the service. It didn't work. He was still drafted, and then Gregory's back on the streets. Gregory spent several years in jail, and it was there that he discovered books of poetry in the prison library. When he got out, he was 20 years old, and it was then that he first met Allen Ginsberg, and they formed a lifelong friendship. This is one of his early poems called Birthplace Revisited, and it goes, "I stand in the dark street, and look up at my window. I was born there. The lights are on. Other people are moving about. And I am with raincoat, cigarette in mouth." Family, they had a chauffeur, a gardener, a maid, and a cook. He went to Harvard, went to graduate school, studied in Austria. And when he first met Allen Ginsberg in 1943, he hadn't even thought of writing as a career. It'd be another 10 years before he wrote his first book, Junkie. So, completely different background than Gregory Corso. And here's a piece typical of Burroughs' writing, composed by cutting up existing words. So, is it prose or is it poetry? I don't know. "Fish smoking, light eat on tracks I told, overcoat in the turnstile, caught he, old photo, couldn't switch iron, cold sore, talk braille, silver flat holes, pain tracks, told him the west side push, you on tracks in cloth smoke, a brown architect, unknown and probably hostile, muttering leg in the night, on the tracks I told, the west side push, you on tracks. The beware look went wrong, cement shoe in junk dawn, shining sores scan a silver message, you strictly from monkey, within the utilities track system. But the mannequin was unable to confirm the account. You crazy or something, walk around alone." That would be a tough poem to translate. Completely different though than Corso. And then there's the Lawrence Ferlinghetti. He's on the far right in this picture.
in front of City Lights bookstore taken more than 50 years ago. Lawrence was born in New York City in 1919, but his father died before he was born. His mother had a nervous breakdown when he was born, so he never knew her. He was raised by an old aunt who took him to France as a baby, and he learned to speak French before he learned English. Eventually, the aunt abandoned Lawrence as a young boy, and he was lucky to be raised by a wealthy family who lived in the suburbs of New York City. So they sent him to prep school and to college. Then he served the duration of World War II in the Navy, went to the Sorbonne, received his doctorate. In 1953, he moved to San Francisco and opened a little bookstore and decided, like in France, that the bookstore should publish books, which is not typical in the United States. So City Lights published their first book, and it was Lawrence Ferlinghetti's book, Pictures of the Gone World. Here's Lawrence with his dog and the poem, "The world is a beautiful place to be born into. If you don't mind happiness not always being so much fun, if you don't mind a touch of hell now and then, just when everything is fine, because even in heaven they don't sing all the time. The world is a beautiful place to be born into, if you don't mind some people dying all the time, or maybe only starving some of the time, which isn't half so bad if it isn't you." And then there's young Allen Ginsberg, born in 1926 in Newark, New Jersey, and I already know two of you were born in Newark, New Jersey here tonight. He lived in a town of Paterson that's about 30 miles from New York City, and his father taught English and wrote poetry. So Allen always said he went into the family business. His mother, though, Naomi, suffered from mental illness and eventually died in a mental hospital. Allen was very bright and graduated from Columbia University, and then after a few years wrote his famous poem, "How," which was tried for obscenity. His poem, "Kaddish," was written a few years later in memory of his mother, and that's his greatest poem, I think. I'll read a few lines from footnote to "How" and give you a sample of his style, in which he says, "Everything is holy, everybody's holy, everywhere is holy, every day is in eternity, every man's an angel, the bum's as holy as a seraphim, the madman is as holy as you, my soul are holy, the typewriter is holy, the poem is holy, the voice is holy, the hearers are holy, the ecstasy is holy, holy Peter, holy Alan, holy Solomon, holy Lucian, holy Kerouac, holy Hunky, holy Burroughs, holy Cassidy, holy the unknown buggered and suffering beggars, holy the hideous human angels." So that's Allen, a completely different type of poetry. And this is Jack Kerouac, born in a small town in near Boston in 1922, Lowell, Massachusetts. His parents were French-Canadian. They didn't speak English at home either. He grew up speaking French at home. He excelled in sports, went to Columbia University, where he played football, and published his first book, The Town and the City, in 1950. It was very much like Thomas Wolfe's novels, and it didn't do very well. And it wasn't until 1957 that his second book was published, and that was On the Road. And that book became a bestseller almost instantly, and made he and his friends famous. It was that fame which helped to destroy Jack Kerouac. And he died in 1969 from his alcoholism. This is the same man who just 15 years later would appear so bloated and sad in that earlier picture I showed. And this is, of course, the famous ending of On the Road that he writes, "So in America, when the sun goes down and I sit on the old broken down river pier watching the long, long skies over New Jersey and sense all that raw land that rolls in one unbelievable huge bulge over to the west coast and all that road going, all the people dreaming in the immensity of it. And in Iowa, I know by now the children must be crying in the land where they let the children cry. and tonight the stars will be out. And don't you know that God is Pooh Bear? The evening star must be drooping and shedding her sparkler dims on the prairie, which is just before the coming of complete night that blesses the earth, darkens all rivers, cups the peaks, and folds the final shore in. Nobody knows what's going to happen to anybody besides the forlorn rags of growing old. I think of Dean Moriarty. I even think of old Dean Moriarty, the father we never found. I think of Dean Moriarty. And Dean Moriarty was the father of Neil Cassady. They went on the road looking for him in On the Road. So once you study their works, I don't see how you could confuse one with another, or why anyone would ever think that they were united in what they were trying to do as a writer. Each one has a distinct, unique voice. They aren't Beat, they're just Kerouac and Burroughs and Ferlinghetti. But the one thing that they did all have in common was this friendship with Allen Ginsberg. And this is them when they first met. That's Hal Chase, who figures in the books, but it wasn't a writer per se. Then Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, and William S. Burroughs up at Columbia University. Now, some of the members of the Beat Generation were not even writers, like Lucian Carr, and that's Lucian in the center between Allen and William Burroughs. He never wrote anything. And Neil Cassady, the hero of many of Kerouac's novels, wrote only one time when Allen forced him to, and he tried to write his own autobiography. And there's Joan Adams, who I showed you before, was the wife of William Burroughs, often considered one of the most important women of the Beat Generation. She never wrote anything. Edie Kerouac never wrote much either, but she's considered one of the founding members of the Beat Generation. Her memoir is the only thing she ever wrote, and that was very late in her life, and there's a copy of that on the table here that we put together after her death. And then there's Carl Solomon, who is a member of the Beat Generation, but wrote very little, and it was Carl who Allen wrote Hal and dedicated Hal to. And there was Peter Orlovsky, who didn't write very much, and there was Herbert Hunke here with Allen, all of whom wrote very little. And in truth, they only did it because Allen made them do it. But they're all still considered important members of the Beat Generation. So that's my question that I have for people. How can you be a member of a literary group if you don't even write? Well, we don't consider all Picasso's friends Cubists, do we? Or Braque's friends aren't all Cubists. So why are all of Allen's friends considered members of the Beat Generation? The next part is hard to illustrate with photographs. The first question I'm usually asked at interviews is, why should we care today about the Beat Generation and what makes them important to us? And usually I don't argue about whether there is or isn't a Beat Generation in those situations, but I give an answer, maybe a two-part answer. First of all, I believe they're important because those writers influence the next generation, my generation really, through their works. And they remain important because their books remain important to us today. When we read them, we can still experience what they experienced at the time that they wrote them. And I think it's also important to point out that all of society and American culture certainly has been changed because of that media attention that was focused on the Beat Generation, whether they were a literary group or not. And here's Allen with his friend Bob Dylan, who wanted to be a poet and came to, in fact, his name is Bob Zimmerman, and he chose Dylan as his name because of Dylan Thomas. And he came to New York because he wanted to be with the poets, the Beat poets at that time, like Allen Ginsberg and Ray Bremser, who was a favorite of Bob Dylan's in the early years. So this small group of kindred spirits were determined to practice absolute personal freedom in a post-war society that was governed by those stifling conservative attitudes. And they set examples that were embraced by the next generation. So most people of the age of the Beat Generation were out making a living. My parents buying the house, the suburban lifestyle, the American dream.
it was that following generation of the 1960s that took up where the Beats left off and created a youth culture that's, to be quite honest, is still with us today. We still live in a youth culture. Some of them, like Jack Kerouac, in fact, developed a style of writing that is used by many people of spontaneous prose, and that influenced countless writers ever since. They wrote the way that people spoke. They always were a catalyst for change in that way. And some of them, like Allen Ginsberg and Lawrence Ferlinghetti, began to write poetry that was meant to be read aloud and not really read on the page. So they broke away from an idea of poetry that T.S. Eliot had that was meant to be enjoyed in a quiet room. They wanted it performed in front of 10,000 people, like Allen's doing here in Albert Hall in London. And some of them engaged in battles over censorship and began the free speech movement that in America developed then into the civil rights movements and the gay rights movements and sexual liberation. Here's William Burroughs with Terry Southern, Allen Ginsberg, and Jean Genet, and they were sent to Chicago to cover the 1968 Democratic Convention there that, that caused so much trouble in America. Some of them became father figures for that later drug culture, although I told you about some that didn't, but some did, and they continued to be interested in psychedelics in the later 1960s. Here's Allen with Timothy Leary's wife, Timothy Leary and Lawrence Ferlinghetti. They were all close friends. Most of these people challenged America's drug laws, and they said that drug users were not criminals, that the problem was a medical problem of addiction. And it's always been the question of why is it okay to use alcohol and tobacco to alter your personality, but not okay to use marijuana or drugs. Some of them became elder statesmen in the sexual revolution and the gay rights revolution. And they looked, that next generation of gay people looked towards Allen Ginsberg and Peter Orlovsky as older spokesmen. The Vietnam War polarized a lot of people in the world, especially in America, of course.
And while most of the Beats joined in the protests, others like Kerouac and Burroughs remained much more conservative. Some like Gary Snyder and Allen Ginsberg helped to start a Back to Nature movement. Now this is Carl Solomon, Allen Ginsberg, Peter Orlovsky, and John Titel, a writer, in front of Allen's farm that he had in the late 60s. It was the Back to Nature movement. Kerouac's writing gave rise to a different type of interest in the environment, something that's called the Rucksack Revolution, where people went hiking and up into the mountains. This is actually the fire spotting tower that Kerouac lived in for a summer and wrote about in his book, Desolation Angel, in particular. Some of the Beats were on a spiritual quest and took an interest in Eastern religions. That's an awareness that's still growing in the West today, in large part because of their proselytizing. And here's Gary Snyder. He's the taller person in the picture. You can spot him pretty easily. He went to Japan in the 1950s, lived there for 10 years in a Buddhist monastery. Others like Burroughs, though, and Gregory Corso had no interest whatsoever in these kinds of spirituality. Here's a picture of Beat poet Phil Whalen in the center, who became a Buddhist teacher as well. Some of the people in this picture, there's Alan, Peter Orlovsky, Allen Ginsberg, Jerome Rothenberg, and it was taken at Naropa, and one of the people here today went to Naropa. That was a first Buddhist college in America, and Allen was the head of the poetics department there. And there are more and more examples of this influence on contemporary culture, but I think that's enough to give you an idea of that. So I'll close just by saying that's how it goes. I don't believe the Beat Generation exists, and yet my next book will be The Beat Generation in the World. So you can see I'm confused by it too. And
if you're confused and have any questions, I'd be glad to answer any questions now.
True. I mean, Burroughs was on no spiritual quest that I know of. It wasn't until his dying breath that he said love was important. He was always on some kind of a psychological exploration, but it was never spiritual. But many of them were on spiritual quests, and I think that's something that, when you look at the press in the 1950s and 1960s, they savaged these men. They really hated them, and they called them know-nothing bohemians, and they came out with, that's why they created beatniks, because these guys were lazy and dirty and knew nothing. And it was just the opposite, that they were almost all looking for something, and whether you want to call that God or whatever, they were looking for it. Jack Kerouac, at the end of his life, he was always a Catholic, but at the end of his life, he really got back to Catholicism. He was searching for something. Alan searched in a different direction. He wanted to find a God in everyone, everything is holy kind of thing. Each person, though, was looking for something, and whether they found it or not, I'm not sure, but in their writing, they're exploring, and they're trying to find something. And like I said, I can't say that about all of them, but that is one of the unifying attributes of many of the people we think of as the Beat Generation.
I just want to add, somebody like Burroughs, you wouldn't want to call it a spiritual quest. But he left something. He left a certain kind of life. You know, and then right. When he left the book, you have to find something, whether it's spiritual or not. Maybe he found it drugs, maybe he found it. But it is a search. Spiritual or not, I don't know. But
in his case, he wasn't taking drugs. You know, the thing of the 60s, it was mind expanding and things. But he was just a junkie. He was hooked on things. And so he wasn't doing it in the way that Alan was very good about taking drugs and never getting addicted. Because Alan was the smartest man you would ever meet. And he knew how often he could take a drug, and he kept a notebook. And if he took heroin, he wouldn't take it for months. And he would have that date in the notebook. He would not take it. Gregory Corso, though, would take one day and take it the next day. He said, well, I'm not hooked, take it the next day. And then he was hooked within the week or whatever. But Alan was so smart that he didn't. Now Burroughs had become hooked. And Burroughs said that people took drugs not because they wanted something, but because their life was empty. And that was, why he got in trouble. And then once they were addicted, very few people could ever break that addiction.
It's interesting that for us, for Italians, or for Europeans probably, that generation meant a lot, also in terms of what we see in America, in the US now. It's completely different from what people thought about US, let's say, before the Second World War or during the Second World War. So they changed our idea of the state, United States, completely. And still now, you know, the idea of, let's say, on the road is the must, let's say, from that generation, from our point of view. And the idea of the United States is a place where you're free of going. You have a street in front of you, you can go, whatever, and you have adventures, and at the same time you feel so free. It's still something that remains with the idea that we have the United States in general. Although life is very different, maybe people accept this or their way of life less than we do here. Because for us, it's like, you know, it's completely different kind of style, the lifestyle that you would have in Europe, anywhere.
It's kind of interesting, the worldwide, the Beats became very popular. In the United States, they were popular and still are popular, but there are countries in the world that really accepted them. And amazingly, as anyone does research, you find that they were translated into Eastern European countries in the 50s and 60s. And they were allowed there because the socialist countries thought that they were anti-American, so that they must be on their team. But they weren't on their team either. They hated those guys as much as they hated the American way. But those books got into Eastern European libraries and hands and helped change that part of the world to become a little more liberal. And Vaclav Havel was a friend of Allen Ginsberg, and he remembers reading On the Road and how, and he was a writer, of course, more than a president of the country. And it was because of that writing that made him start the Hungarian Revolution, this Velvet Revolution. Changes were made because The governments are always stupid. They just thought, oh, they're saying bad things about the United States. If we publish them, people will hate the United States. But they were really saying bad things about that, the authority figures who were in control of everything. And I believe it is the same in any country in the world. It's not the people speaking, it's someone guiding the people's lives. Yes?
You mentioned how these particular group of writers influenced future generations, but how were they influenced?